கேடில் வெளிச்செல்வம் கல்வி ஒருவருக்கு மாடல்ல மற்றையவை. வாய் திருக்குறள் இட் மீன்ஸ் தட் The wealth that never declines is learning. All others are not riches. With this history, Tamil society gives emphasis to the learning. And the present form of learning or the education starts with the history of British colonial period. And after independence, the rule of constitution comes into the society. We have to look at how the Indian government has been spending for the education, because education is very important for the society. Because of the free education, I'm standing here, because I'm the first graduate from my whole family. It gave me opportunity to express the concerns of my society. It helps me to articulate what the government should look into the people and the children. To large section of people, education was forbidden. We should not forget that, because large section of people should not learn, should not get into the education. This is what our history. We can't compare the other countries, the developing countries or underdeveloped countries, those who are into the colonial system. Because we are coming out of colonial system, but also we have to come out of the regressive caste system, which forbidden the most of the population from the education. And with this thing, I would like to go into the details how the government has been looking at the education and its the funding. It took nearly 60 years for us to make the right to education. Because education is not as a fundamental right being put onto the constitution. And it's been 60 years for giving the right to the people, to the children, to access their basic right. And if you look at the where we are standing now, let's look at from the World Bank data on 2013. They said that government spending on education by both central and state governments in India is 3.8%. Of which is lesser than the world average of about 4.7% of GDP. 6 years ago, that is 2012, the expenditure is 3.1%. It fell in 2014 to 2.8% and further dropped in 2015-16 to 2.4%. So in Kothari Commission, about 50 years before, we aimed for 6%, and where we are standing now is 2.4%. This is how the spending has been happening in India. Though we are talking about a big picture about India in the international arena, without educating the masses, how are we going to build up a stronger nation? How are we going to liberate our people from the caste system or the system that enslaves a large section of the people? The national policy on education in 1986 and the program of action 1992 envisaged that free and compulsory education of satisfactory quality should be provided to all children of up to 14 years. But we haven't spent enough on this, because these are big claims that put forward by the Indian government, but they are not giving an importance to this particular sections. If you look at the Narendra Modi government, they've been reducing spending on education. It dropped, and the budget estimates, from 1% of this country's income in the government's first budget in 2014 to 0.62% in 2018. Its share in the budget too has been slashed from 6.15% to 3.7%, nearly halved. So this is the status of the Indian educational system, and we are talking about how we are going to improve the society and we're making India is a more powerful country. Let's look at the figures about Sarva Siksha Abhiyan. It's a national program for universal elementary education. In the total allocation, it dropped to 29% from 31%, which was in 2016-17. In 2018, it dropped to 29%. So this is how the government has been looking at the education. So I'm really worried about this government's intentions. Because you are reducing the spending on to the elementary education and higher secondary education, which means that you don't want the larger section of this country, the children, to come to the schools or getting the access to the education. This is what the real picture. What I'm saying is the real picture. And let's look at how the infrastructure has been maintained. Here, one small example. Of the 6 million teaching positions in government schools nationwide, about 900,000 elementary school teaching positions and 100,000 in secondary school put together, 1 million teaching positions are vacant. This is the situation of the current system. So if you look at the marginalized section, let's look at the national data of the National Campaign on Dalit Human Rights report brought to public notice. The scholarship arrears of the last 3 years for SCST students is amounting to 8,000 crores. 8,000 crores. This means that 71,36,934 students' life has been affected because of these arrears. This is how the Indian government is spending. They are giving a large claims that, yes, we are going to bring a powerful India. It's a large claims, but look at the data. The data is disappointing. Let's look at how the other country is spending on it. Because we are speaking about the upliftment of the people, but we are not ready to look at the other countries, how they are spending. Let's look at the third world countries. Some of the third world countries do spend a lot of money on the education. Let's look at the Cuba. They are the highest spender in the world. They're spending 13% of the GDP. 13% of the GDP. So the education is the illiteracy rate is almost nil in Cuba. How come it is possible? Despite so many embargoes on this country, the country could be able to share about 13% on that. Let's look at the East Timor. It's 11.3% and Denmark is 8.7% and France is spending about close to 6%. And Germany is 5.1% and UK is 6.2%, but India is 2.4%. This is how the spending has been happening, and we've been entering into the area of privatizing the education. So I'm really worried, because if the education been privatized immediately after 1947, I would have not been standing here. I would have been standing somewhere outside. I would not get into the schools. I would get the opportunity to go to the postgraduate institutions. But now the government, after the WTO agreement, which they have the signed in the guards and other things, they're making it, the education as a private profit-centric industry. They're making it as an industry. So if you're making education as an industry, how the large section of the people of India could be able to come out of their poverty? How we're going to break the vicious cycle of the poverty? If a person is getting educated, they have the ability to go for a work or become employable. They could be able to have a dignified life because of the employability, because of the capability. And with that capability, they or their family could come out of the poverty. But now, the government is pushing them to that section. So
Murugan, can we wind up in about half a minute?
Yeah. Thank you. So, before I want to end up, I want to quote what Ambedkar informed. Education is something which ought to be brought within reach of everyone. The education department is not a department which can be treated on the basis of quid pro quo. Education ought to be cheapened in all possible ways and to the greatest possible extent. It is the education which is right weapon to cut the social slavery, and it is education which will enlighten the downtrodden masses to come up and gain social status, economic betterment and political freedom. This is what Ambedkar informed about the education in India. And if you look at the present status of the government, or on a whole, we are not spending on education. We are moving the society to the Manodharma period, where the large section of people be forbidden with education.